So, current outbreak of COVID-19 has rapidly expanded over a short time. The number of cases have increased more than 1.5 crore globally, and they continue to increase despite the austere measures being taken. Now, during this ongoing COVID, many patients with known, suspected, or unknown COVID infection status will require surgery and general anesthesia for tracheal intubation and extubation for both respiratory and non-respiratory reasons. So both these intubation and extubations are important. Now, good knowledge of infection prevention and control, vigilance in protecting doffing, which Dipti has explained very nicely, and preparedness for the case is of utmost importance. A prepared airway practitioner is one who performs safe airway management, displaying the skills, knowledge, and full awareness of human factors with a culture of safety. Such practitioners should aim for expertise rather than competence. Now, in this lecture, I would briefly discuss the guidelines which were developed from the Difficult Airway Society, the Association of Anesthetists and the Intensive Care Society, Faculty of Intensive Care Medicine, and the Royal College of Anesthetists, and the advisory position statement, which was developed by the Indian Society of Anesthesiologists. Now, what they do not advise is when to intubate, the ethics of decision-making around escalation of care, or indemnity for the staff. Now, before we just go into the airway, let us look up at how this OT should be set up. So, there should be dedicated theaters. Now, if you're going to operate a positive or a suspected patient, you should have dedicated theaters in a separate OT complex, and there should be a label on top of it that these are COVID theaters. Now, the location of these theaters is very, very important. It should be either in a separate block about 20 meters where you do not have anything else, and they should be on the same floor as an ICU or an HDCU. But if you're having it in the same complex, then you should have it as the initial first two theaters so that there is no cross-infection with to the next theaters. And if it is advisable, if you're having it in the operation theater, minimum of two theaters should be there. One for the general surgery and the orthopedic procedures, and second is for the obstetrics. Now, these theaters should also have separate changing rooms, both for the male and female, with the shower and the toilet facility. The doffing and donning area should also be there. The donning area should have a chair. It should have ample amount of PPE, and it should have a hand sanitization area. The doffing area should have a waste bin for the throwing your PPE kits and hand sanitization area. And there should be a separate entry and exit for both the donning and doffing area, so there is no mixing of the healthcare workers. So what is the basis of COVID airway management? Now, this can be described by a mnemonic, SARS. SARS means safe for the staff and patient, accurate, that is avoiding unreliable, unfamiliar, or repeated techniques, and swift, that is timely without any rush or delay. Now, as it is said, that when you prepare nicely for anything, work is half done. So that is what happens in a COVID, when you prepare a theater for a COVID positive patient. Preparation is very important. The equipment for routine and difficult intubation, that is all sorts of tubes, the supraglottic airways, the laryngoscopes, the stilettes, bougie, everything should be there in your hand. Adequate trained staff. Now, this is of great importance because it is in this era that you want to have a minimum staff available for your help. So the staff you have should be adequately trained, who know what you want, and they should be ready to look at your communication, because communication is also bad when you are wearing a PPE, when you're wearing goggles, and when you're wearing a shield. So communication is bad. You should have an intubation checklist, which should be done prior to intubation, and availability of proper PPE should be there. Second most important thing is how to use the PPE correctly. Now, this Dipti has described very nicely, that donning and doffing. Donning, everybody does properly, I know, but doffing is what is very important. And she has shown a beautiful video of how the doffing should be done. And second important thing is you should predict and prepare for a difficult airway. For this, you can use a MACOCA score, which involves Malampati grade 3 or 4. then apnea, that is the obstructive sleep apnea syndrome, then cervical spine, where the limitation of movement is less than 3 centimeters, opening of the mouth is less than 1 millimeter, coma, hypoxia, or when there is a non-anesthesiologist. So when this 4 exceeds 2, you need to call a senior anesthesiologist or an experienced anesthesiologist for help. Second thing is you create a COVID-19 tracheal intubation trolley. Now, a trolley like this has to be created in which you keep all the necessary equipments which are required, covered with the cling wrap, and they can be kept inside the OT. So they are covered nicely and they cannot be easily contaminated. Now, this is a beautiful diagram which shows involve you minimum number of staff. That is, you can do with three people inside when you're intubating the patient. One is the intubator, that is you who will be intubating the patient. Second is the person who's going to help you give drugs and look at the monitor for you, because you have the back towards the monitor. And the third person is who's going to give required pressure if needed and would hand over to you the equipment, that is the laryngoscope tube or the video laryngoscope if it is needed. And there will be one person outside, that is a runner, who would be looking from the window and would be needed if you need anything from outside. You should wear an appropriate check PPE kit, which should have a face shield or goggles, an N95 or a higher mask, one pair of gloves. It is generally advocated that you use two pair of gloves, and the first pair of gloves you can fold over the laryngoscope and they can be removed. And an isolation gown which is impervious to liquids. Now, aerosol generation. Now, this is very, very important, especially because you're going to intubate the patient. So, sources of potential aerosol generation during airway management, there might be aerosol generating events, or there might be procedures which are vulnerable to aerosol generation. So these aerosol generating events are basically involve the gas flow, and there will be a high gas flow involved. So these may be like coughing, sneezing, expectoration, non-invasive ventilation or positive pressure ventilation with inadequate seal, especially when you're using a face mask or a supraglottic airway or an endotracheal tube whose cuff has not been inflated. So you will have an inadequate seal. High flow nasal oxygen, jet ventilation, delivery of nebulized or atomized medications via simple face mask, CPR when it is done before intubation, and tracheal extubation. Now, these are the procedures which are vulnerable to aerosol generation, but they themselves do not cause any aerosol generation. They will generate only when you give a positive pressure ventilation. Tracheal suction without an inline closed system, laryngoscopy, tracheal intubation, bronchoscopy, they will generate aerosol when the patient coughs, and the tracheostomy when you give a positive pressure ventilation from above, when you have a tracheal tube in place. The process of airway management is an increased risk period for aerosol-based transmission because the patient may become agitated or combative due to hypoxia. The patient's mask has to be removed. The clinicians are near the patient's airway. Laryngoscopy and intubation are vulnerable to aerosol generation, and aerosol generating events are more likely. So these are the risk factors for aerosol generation. It might be coughing. So how do you protect it? You wear a proper PPE, minimize the time between the mask removal and the face mask application. A good seal with the face mask and viral filter should be there. Ensure profound paralysis, that is give muscle relaxants, and manage the tracheal extubation. Second is, if you have an inadequate face mask seal during pre-oxygenation. So how do you protect it? You have a well-fitting mask with a viral filter, VE grip. Now this I'll show you the diagram later on. Manual ventilation device with a collapsible bag, and you should have an ETCO2 monitoring, which shows as soon as that you are ventilating the patient properly. Then positive pressure ventilation with an inadequate seal. So you avoid the positive pressure ventilation. The good seal is obtained in the this ascending order is from the face mask, the supraglottic airway, and the endotracheal tube. Now, when you pass the endotracheal tube, you should ensure that the cuff is below the cords and you properly secure the endotracheal tube. Then manual ventilation with the collapsible bag, airway manometry, and a neuromuscular blockade. the high gas flow, so you avoid the high flow nasal oxygen. Now, there is a very common saying that practice makes a man perfect. So it is very important in this COVID era that you should focus on promptness and reliability. That is, you should have a person who has a lot of experience and who does not fumble in intubation. Secondly, you should use the techniques that have been used since a long time. You should not opt for new, because if you opt for a new technique, you are definitely going to land up in a chaos and confusion. Use a kit dump mat. A video laryngoscopy is what is ideal and it is generally recommended. But a lot of our hospitals do not have video laryngoscopy. So you should use a laryngoscope with which you are familiar and comfortable with. A 2-person, 2-handed mask ventilation with a VE grip is advocated, because you do not want any leak from the face mask, because it will cause aerosol generation. And secondly, you're not going to give positive pressure ventilation. So you should have a proper seal of the face mask. And a second generation supraglottic airway for rescue should always be there. Now, this is the kit dump mat. It is basically a trolley that you can create with all the emergency things that you required for intubation. That is the oropharyngeal airway, the stilet, bougies, tubes, the ambu bag, a suction, a magyl forceps, and the tube clamp, etc. Now, this is the grip that I was talking about. Now, what we usually use before in the pre-COVID area is this kind of grip. It is the CE grip with a single hand. But what is advocated nowadays is the VE grip, because you want to have a tight seal on the mask. And if a ventilation is necessary, there is another person who's there and who licks and who can press the back. So again, I would emphasize that there should be a most experienced anesthetist. Use familiar techniques. Ensure that all the necessary equipment in the OT, including the monitor, working suction, ventilator, working IV access should be there. And remove all non-essential equipment and gadgets which are not needed outside the OT, because you do not want to contaminate them. Equipment, you cover all the monitors, cable, anesthesia workstation, machine, cautery, OT table, patient trolley with a transparent, water-resistant plastic sheets or a cling wrap can be used. And use disposable equipment as far as possible. That is the disposable anesthesia circuit, tubes, and in some cases they are using even disposable video laryngoscope blades. The solar lime should be disposed after each case, and the canister should be cleaned with either sterilium or 1% hypochlorite. And the other things like the bag or the face mask should be decontaminated and sent properly packed. They should be put in a Ziploc bag and then sent for ETO. Now, HME filters. That is the heat and moisture exchanger with viral filters. Now, two should be used. The first should be between the tube and the breathing circuit, and the second should be between the expiratory limb and the breathing circuits. Now, basically, these HME filters can remove up to 99% of the airborne particles of 0.3 micron or greater, and thus they help in preventing contamination of the operation theater. If the patient is COVID positive already, then you can use a third filter which is attached to the tracheal tube. Now, this is just a small algorithm which will show the tracheal intubation in the critically ill adults for COVID-19. You should don the PPE, you should pre-oxygenate. Since you're not going to give positive pressure ventilation, pre-oxygenation is very, very important. Up to 5 minutes of pre-oxygenation is very good. Position head up if possible, assess the airway and identify the cricothyroid membrane. ETCO2 monitor should be connected beforehand. Pre-oxygenate the patient with the HME filter. If the patient is in ICU or something, then you optimize the cardiovascular system and share the blood. Laryngoscopy, maximum of 3 attempts are allowed. And you maintain the oxygenation. And if you need to do positive pressure ventilation, then very low bag movements should be done by the other attendant. Full neuromuscular block is given. That is, you go in for rapid sequence intubation. You can use either succinylcholine 1.5 milligram per kilogram or rocuronium 0.9 to 1 milligram per kilogram for your intubation. Video laryngoscopy with or without bougie can be done. External laryngeal manipulation may be required and remove this thing. If it is the first failure, then you should call for help and the person entering should don the PPE beforehand. If it is a failed intubation, then you can either put in a supraglottic airway, second generation, or again ventilate with a tight grip or the mask. Again, if you succeed, it is fine. Otherwise, it will be a cannot intubate, cannot oxygenate position. And in this, you have to go in for tracheostomy, that is the front of the neck accessibility. So this is what happens when you can't intubate, cannot oxygenate. That is, you go in for the FONA, that is the front of the neck airway. Now, this is the checklist for the emergency tracheal intubation in COVID-19. Personal protective equipment. The doctor should don the personal protective equipment properly. Then outside the room, you should check that all the equipment is there along with the drugs. And the drugs which are required should be there. If it is a small child, then the weight should be taken and any allergy should be noted. Then prepare for difficulty. You should have all the equipment required for a difficult intubation, especially a supraglottic airway of a second generation should be there. Then inside the room, you assess the airway by the MAC-CoCa score, identify the cricothyroid, apply the monitor. ETCO2 monitoring is mandatory these days, along with the normal monitoring, that is the ECG, pulse oximeter, and the NIBP. Check the IV access, optimize the position of the patient, do pre-oxygenation at least for 3 minutes, 5 minutes would be very good, and optimize the patient condition before tracheal intubation. The airway management, once you intubate the patient after rapid sequence then inflate the cuff, check the wave of the ETCO2 monitor, then push and check all the connections are in place. Clamp the tracheal tube if you have to disconnect the circuit at any time because you do not want any aerosol generation. Now, then fix the tube properly. After the tube has been fixed, then you can insert the nasogastric tube and consider if you want, you can take a deep tracheal sample after this. After your case is over, you remove the PP and you can clean the room after 20 minutes. Now, just a few changes in the pediatric airway. Basically, it is the same. Important is the weight of the child, because you would prepare the drugs and keep the equipments and the size of the tube according to the weight of the child. Open all the trash can, because pediatric a child is not going to give you any time to open the dustbins and put in your trash in that. So everything should be kept open in this case. Pre-medication can be given to reduce the crying and aerosol generation, avoid the nasal intubation, and avoid parental presence, especially in COVID-19 patients. Induction, generally the intravenous induction is preferred over the mask induction. And similarly, the rapid sequence intubation with the neuromuscular blocker can be used. If you need a mask, then the lowest possible flow can be done and use a plastic barrier. The pediatric airway, the cuff tube is preferred. LMA with a good seal is also acceptable. Video laryngoscope is preferred, and a simple face mask may also reduce the aerosol. Again, in this case, the most experienced anesthetist. A nasal cannula with a bag and mask is not advocated. Inline closed suction should be used, and fix the tube very properly, because it is in these small kids that the tube can be displaced very easily. So fixation is very, very important. Difficult airway, assemble the team and equipment, most experienced anesthesiology. The first choice is video laryngoscopy. Second is a fiber optic through the LMA. Third is the fiber optic with video laryngoscopy. And fourth is the tracheostomy. Consider neuromuscular block, 2 persons for bag and mask, avoid passive oxygenation, and use LMA as a rescue device. The procedure, during the procedure, keep your PPE on. Utilize a plastic barrier if you're using an LMA. Emergence, complete recovery should be in the OT, and in-light closed suctioning should be done. A plastic barrier, you can keep a plastic barrier on top of the face. Consider deep extubation and avoid cuffing in a child. Now, scavenging. Now, this is one thing which is very important, but all our operation theaters do not have any active scavenging is there. So what we are doing these days is a corrugated rubber tubing is applied to the scavenging port, and it is dipped in a bucket containing 1% sodium hypochlorite or soap water. Now, communication in these theaters is also very difficult, because you're wearing face shield, goggles, PPE kit, so nobody is going to hear you. So you have to devise another way of communicating, and there should be no phones taken inside the OT. An intercom should be there, and if necessary, if the, you don't have an intercom, then a mobile with a plastic cover can be used, and a single one should be there to inform in case of any difficulty. One important thing is, once you enter the operation theater, first check there is adequate central supply. And any cylinder which is in the OT and it has to be sent outside, any CO2 cylinder or oxygen or nitrous, anything, it should be cleaned with this 1% sodium hypochlorite, because you are going to send that cylinder to the filling station where it is going to be filled. So this cylinder goes from a COVID theater, so it has to be sanitized properly. Now, air conditioning is also, because all our theaters are positive air conditioning, so goal is to ensure that virus laden particles do not leak out and maintain the concentration of the virus laden particles to minimum. What we have in our theaters is the heating ventilating air conditioning system. That is, it is of a recirculatory type, where air from the OT is taken back into the air handling unit for thermal conditioning and it is brought back. So all our operation theaters have positive pressure. Now, how can you make it negative pressure? Is you can put in some exhaust blowers. The exhaust blower, they should have the exhaust, the quantity of the exhaust air should be greater than the supply, so that a minimum negative pressure of 2.5 pascals is created. If you create more than 5 pascals, then it is very nice. And secondly, the supply of the air quantity should provide a minimum of 12 changes per hour. What you can do is you can put in standalone air conditioners also, depending on the size of the theater. 2 standalone air conditioners of about 2 tons can be put, and this can be, the exhaust can be connected to the HEPA filters. So ideally, there should be a central air conditioning with dedicated fresh air cycles with HEPA filters and independent air handling units. Now, sterilization and decontamination. Enough time should be there between the 2 cases. Hydrogen peroxide spray, 1% sodium hypochlorite or 75% alcohol can be used. You should discard the disposables. As I've said earlier, all the used airway equipment is sealed in a Ziploc and removed for decontamination. All the equipment is sent to CSSD covered in plastic caps. Now, this is an interesting thing that I came across in from Times of India. It is the concept of green OT. Now, there is only one green OT presently in India, that is the Bhagwan Mahavir Operation Theatre in Bangalore. So what they do is use of cleaner and modern techniques and technology process with sensitivity to environment. It leads to increased sensitivity among people toward environment-friendly practices. So it covers all the OT parameters like the airflow, OT setup, setup of volatile agent, use filling system, and scavenging system in place. So this is what is needed, is the need of time, and it raises the safety bar of the operation theaters. Now, since this COVID has come up, a lot of innovations have come up for intubation. Now, one is the intubation box, which we are using in our theaters also. Now, whether it is an extra layer of safety or a false sense of security, this is still questionable. Because if you land up in a difficult intubation through a box, it leads to chaos. And secondly, intubating a very small child through this intubating box is very cumbersome. Basically, it is a silicon-based box with 2 openings. I think most of the people in Indore are having it, where you can put your hands and do intubation through that. And it has 2 openings in the side over here, which are covered with a Velcro. And this is the open end. Now, what I do is I cover this open end with a sheet, which is taped on here, so that to create as much as negative pressure that I can. And secondly, I have made a hole on top of this and inserted a suction catheter in it. And this I connected to a suction so that some amount of negative pressure is created during intubation. Second thing is an extubation barrier drape. Now, this is what was published in the British Journal of Anesthesia in April. In this, what is done is a 1 to 2 centimeter slit is made in the center of a plastic sheet. And before the patient comes out of anesthesia, the ventilator is stopped, the gas flow is reduced to 0, and the APL valve is open, and the tube is clamped, and the circuit is disconnected from the tube, and the plastic sheet is placed over the patient. And the tracheal tube and the cuff inflation adapter is threaded through this. So after that, the tracheal tube is reconnected to the circuit, the clamp is removed, the flows and the ventilator is restarted. The sheet is basically taped here to the tube so that it forms a tight connection over here. So when the patient is ready for the extubation, you deflate the cuff and you remove the tube along with the sheet so that if there is any cough or anything, it is on the undersurface of the sheet and it can be removed en masse. So this decreases some amount of aerosol during extubation. Another thing which was published is the corona curtain. This was published in the Open Access in May 20. So it describes an intuitively pragmatic, simple, innovative and cost-effective approach to attenuating the inherent risk of aerosol exposure with this COVID-19 to staff and providers during emergency intubation. So basically, they make it is an assembly which is attached to a bed or table. It is pre-assembled beforehand and you put it there and so cover it the patient. This is how it looks like and it has two holes here. So all the procedures are carried out inside this curtain. Here you can see the intubation being done inside the curtain through the video laryngoscope. Now, we have discussed about intubation. Extubation is as much important for aerosol generation as much as intubation. So the following recommendations should be observed. The patient should be extubated when he is ready for extubation on the face mask. There should be two people for extubation. The same level of PPE should be maintained. Patient should not be encouraged to cough. Like earlier we used to say, Baba, khans ke batao, now nothing like this is to be said. Strategies to minimize the coughing during extubation includes use of intravenous opioids, lidocaine or Dexona, various things are being used, and you place a plastic sheet over the patient's face during extubation. A simple oxygen mask should be placed on the patient immediately post-extubation, and oral suction should be done, but care taken not to precipitate any coughing. So this is another new thing which can be used, is you keep the mask over the patient, and then when the patient is ready for extubation, you extubate under the mask.